Welcome everybody. Thank you for joining us today for this webinar by Hong Kong Baptist University. My name is Sam Wong and I am the admissions manager at Hong Kong Baptist University. Here am I. So I have been working in higher education for over 15 years and actually specialized in college admission for 10 years. And I'm very happy today to be joined by our full scholarship student, Manoj. Can you say hi to us, Manoj?
Hello and namaste to all our valuable audiences out there. This is me, Manoj Chamlagai, and I am from a small Himalayan country, Nepal. Back in Nepal, I graduated my high school from Xavier International College and middle school from Occidental Public School. Currently, I am a year one student in a broad-based program called Bachelor's of Science Honors at HKBU. I plan to become a researcher in the field of biotechnology in future. Thank you.
Thank you, Manoj. All right, so before we jump into the Hong Kong Baptist experience, I would like to discuss with you quickly why we have to discuss about college at the first place. I know we all grown up with the idea that we will go to high school, graduate and go to college, get a diploma, and then we'll become someone we really want to be. But is that true? Speaking as a student and also someone who worked in higher education for so long, I would say other than the diploma itself, it takes a little bit more. It takes the fireworks. It takes the experience. And I use firework here because experience should be intense, it should be beautiful, it should wow you. And with that, together with quality education, you might become someone you want to be. Now that's what we think college should be, and that's what we are offering you at HKBU. We can't stop, you know, start talking about HKBU experience without talking about HK. So Hong Kong is many different things. It's for first and foremost, a cosmopolitan. I'm pretty sure many of you are familiar with the skyline of Hong Kong, a beautiful skyline. We have been through a lot in the past 10 to 12 months, as you can see from the news, just like this graph. But there are things that remain unchanged. For example, we are still the primary foreign investment gateway for China. In fact, China received $62.9 billion via Hong Kong, and that's the number from last August, and that accounts for 70% of the total foreign investment they received. So the damage might be here, but not as bad as we thought. And we are still on the third on Global Financial Centers Index, right after London and New York, and that's actually the ranking from last September. And of course, we didn't change our geographical strategic location, which is still within the reach of half of the world's population in 5 hours of flight. That's what made Hong Kong still an ideal location for finance and business. Now, Hong Kong is also a city with great diversity. So if you have ever been to Hong Kong, you'll be familiar with the food. We have over 50 Michelin star restaurants offering different kinds of cuisines, and we celebrate diversity in culture, and we have the freedom of religion here. And of course, we have different lifestyle. You see, there are many people who come to me and say, I don't like to shop, so I don't want to go to Hong Kong. Well, you are missing it, buddy, because 40% of the city is actually reserved as country park. As you can see from the photo here, there's beautiful scenery, and many people actually come to Hong Kong for hiking, and that's what our students enjoy as well. Now, Hong Kong is a city for everyone, but maybe Manoj can tell us why you choose Hong Kong.
Yes, Sam, thank you. The first reason why I chose Hong Kong is the research prospects that are available in Hong Kong. Actually, over the past two decades, Hong Kong has achieved the phenomenal growth mainly in the field of drug discovery and quantum computing. A confirmation of this can be found in INSEAD's Global Innovation Input Index, in which Hong Kong ranks 8th out of 129 countries in 2019. The second reason I chose Hong Kong is because Hong Kong is the second largest funding hub for biotechnology. Recently, two new research clusters have been established in Hong Kong. They are Health Innovation Hong Kong for healthcare technologies, which I would be most interested in, and Air Innovation Hong Kong for artificial intelligence and robotics. The third reason why I chose Hong Kong is because it is the financial hub in Asia. Located in the center of the Asia, many international top banks have established their regional headquarters in Hong Kong. So according to my belief, the same may be yours, that where there are more financial activities, where there are more business activities, there will of course be more career prospects. That is why I chose Hong Kong. The fourth reason why I chose Hong Kong is because it is home to regional headquarters of many multinational corporates. Located at a stone's throw distance from mainland China, many international corporates have established their regional headquarters here, which again strengthens the job market in Hong Kong. Similarly, Hong Kong government is very welcoming to international talents. International students are in fact allowed to stay up to 1 year after their graduation to stay in Hong Kong and seek for job. As an international student, I would always be interested to work in a place where I study. And the last but not the least reason why I chose Hong Kong is because of the availability of the courses that are taught in English, still the world's lingua franca, and a good chance to be acquainted with Chinese language, which I think will be more and more sought after, even in the East as well as in the West in the near future. And apart from my campus life, I take a taxi ride just by speaking in English. I did not know any Chinese language in the very beginning. Now I am learning it, but with due respect, even a taxi driver understands English language here. And I buy groceries from stores just by speaking English, and we can find road signs or signals that are written in English as well as in Chinese language here in Hong Kong. So with my experience, I can assure you, or I can say that even if you do not know any Chinese language, then also you can live a normal life here in Hong Kong.
I'm impressed, you know, you do your own grocery. That's great, Manoj. Well, after Hong Kong, we have to move on to BU before we jump into the experience part. So let's have a quick glance on HKBU. So we were founded by the Baptist Convention in 1956. We are relatively young. Even though with the history, with the heritage, we are opening our doors to all. So you don't have to be religious to join HKBU. We have a rather small student population. We have only 7,100 undergraduate students, which makes us the second smallest in terms of undergraduate enrollment. And that's why the amazing student faculty ratio of 15-1. Given the size of our student population, we have quite a lot of exchange partners. There are over 350 of them in over 40 countries. And we receive over 550 international students every year, which makes it a very internationalized campus. And as Manoj mentioned, English is the medium of instruction, so you don't have to worry about language when you come to study with us. Now, I just want to give you a quick idea of where we are and what is it like on campus. This is a part of our campus, and I am speaking right here in this building on the 7th floor is our academic and administrative building. Here is our building for communication and visual arts. Here's the home of a business school. And this is actually our students' residence. As you can see, you know, it's surrounded by green, a lot of green. There is a great park nearby with a basketball court and swimming pool. And behind us, there is the beautiful Lion Rock, which is the infamous mountain in Hong Kong. Now, maybe Manoj can explain why you choose HKBU.
Well, thank you, Sam. I guess it is always a dream of an international student to go to a reputed and prestigious university abroad. So after I confirmed myself that I will study in Hong Kong, then I started searching about the universities, and I found HKBU to be the one that I searched for, I required for, I longed for. Hong Kong Baptist University ranks 27th in QS top 50 under 50 in 2020 ranking. Similarly, you will get world-class faculty members here in Hong Kong. And I can't leave this slide without talking about Dr. Ma. He was my lecturer of chemistry during my first semester. And he and his team has recently developed an inhibitor that can treat triple negative breast cancer. Can you imagine it? You get a world-class researcher as your teacher in HKBU. Actually, I think I have made a right decision now by applying to HKBU. And moving on, HKBU provides research experience and global exposure even in the undergraduate level. On the slides, you can see one of the programs from the Department of Computer Science, which allows students from year 3 to experience a PhD level research during their studies. And apart from this program also, there are many other programs of Baptist University, and it sends university in exchange program, internships, and research opportunities abroad with subsidy. And this will be talked more in detail by Ms. Sam in the later slides.
All right, thank you, Manoj. So we can finally go into the experience. Now I have categorized the experience into three major areas: classroom learning, out of classroom learning, and global exposure. Now I want to start with classroom learning, which are the programs themselves. So we have actually seven faculties offering over 40 different majors. And I'll start with our Faculty of Arts, which has an amazing lineup for the Bachelor of Arts program. You may notice here there are a letter B and P here. So B actually stands for broad-based admission, meaning when you apply, you do not have to choose your major. You will apply, for example, to Bachelor of Arts. And in your first year, you can choose subjects from different majors and get a taste of it before settling down with one. Or if you are very determined that you want to do, for example, humanities, you can also go for P, the program-based admission, meaning you will start with applying to a specific major. So as you can see here, we have six different majors under Bachelor of Arts, and we also have two programs on music, one in music and one in music in creative industries, where our students are taught to make music for film and TV and advertising, and also we have a program on English language and teaching. Our business school is among top 1% of the world's triple crown business school, and we are the only one that is triple accredited in Hong Kong. Going into an accredited school, a triple crown business school, is first, you will get guaranteed quality education, and secondly, you get to access the whole network of accredited school. So if you are interested in business program, you should definitely check out the accreditation. So we offer three bachelor program here. Again, you see the B. So we offer BBA in broad-based, meaning you will apply for BBA and you do not have to choose a concentration until your second year. In fact, many of our students choose more than one concentration when they arrive in their second year. So if you're interested in accounting, you can go directly, apply directly to accounting as it's a professional major, or you can apply for computing with business, which is what you see at the bottom, the business computing and data analytics program. So it's an amazing program combining two. It only takes, again, the same for other program, 4 years. So you may also notice there is an overseas double logo here. It's because we run double degree with Simon Fraser in Canada. So if you join this degree, in the first 2 years, you'll be studying in Hong Kong. In the third and fourth year, you'll be studying in Canada. And at the end, you will receive 2 degrees, one from us and one from Simon Fraser in business. Our School of Chinese Medicine is actually the first to offer undergraduates in Chinese medicine, and it runs 17 clinics in the city that offers Chinese medical services to the public, and is also where our students do their practicum. And we are also the only provider of pharmacy in Chinese medicine in Hong Kong. So a quick note for those who are interested, you have to be able to speak and read Chinese if you would like to apply for these two programs. Our School of Communication is actually ranked top in Asia by Asian correspondents, and is accredited by International Advertising Association. And again, this is a broad-based program, meaning you do not have to choose your major. So you can apply for Bachelor of Communication first, and then in your second year, you can choose either for journalism or public relations and advertising. And there are different concentrations under these majors as well. So if you're interested in film studies, there are the animation media arts or film and television for you to choose. And if you are into, you know, on the screen action, then you can offer our new program, which is the acting for global screen. Faculty of Science is very keen on research, as Manoj mentioned, you know, the example. So we receive news letter every now and then on their innovation, their finds out, and it's exciting. So again, it's a broad-based program. And as you can see, there is a great lineup. You can go for, you know, biology, chemistry, computer science is also here. We have a new program on bioresources and agriculture science if you're into agriculture, organic farming, and sustainability. And you will see the business computing here again because it's a joint program by business and science. And Also, we offer double degree again with Simon Fraser. So for students who join this program, you will gain a degree with HKBU for Maths and Stats, and then a true science with Simon Fraser. Our social sciences have a fantastic choice for social science subjects, as you can see here, geography, government, international study, history, sociology. We have a very special PE and recreation management program. If your favorite subject is PE, you can actually study PE in college. And I want to spend a few minutes on this European studies program that we offer. There are two streams, the French stream and the German stream. So you do not have to know the language beforehand. In the first 2 years, you study in Hong Kong, you study the language and also the related subject. In the third year, you'll be spending the entire year in a French or German-speaking country. And in your fourth year, you will come back, finish your study. And many of our students will work in, you know, embassy, chamber of commerce, UN offices. It's a great choice of career for this program. And they also have a double degree with a Sciences Po in France. So it works like this. First 2 years in HKBU, starting from the third year, you go to France in Sciences Po. After 3 years, a total of 5 years, you will get 2 degrees, one bachelor degree with HKBU and a master degree with Sciences Po. Last but not least, our Academy of Visual Arts. So it's the first practice-based academy for visual arts. And as you can see from the photo, they have loads of studio for different kinds of arts. So you have painting, glass blowing, jewelry, sculpture. And on the other side, you see a beautiful photo of our Kaita campus, which is designated for our visual arts program. And you can see the colonial architecture because it used to be the aviation camp for the British Army. Now I have finished the classroom learning part. I want to jump into the more exciting, more fun out of classroom learning experience. So I want to highlight four major areas here. And the first one I want to talk about is internship, because everybody is talking about internship nowadays. And of course we do offer internship at HKBU. So there are always many questions about internship, and I want to go through that with you, some usual suspects. Is internship credit bearing at HKBU? Yes, but it can also be non-credit bearing. Now, the great thing about credit bearing is that you can do it during your study. You can plan it as part of your study in that year. But for a non-credit bearing internship, you have more flexibility on the time and the employer and the format, and you can do it as you wish to gain, you know, extra work experience. It usually is arranged by the university. Yes, we do offer help to our students. Usually there will be a list of openings so our student can apply for, but it can also be arranged by students, so we can go look for something that you're interested in and discuss with your advisor to see if that meets with the university requirement. And can you engage the community in your internship? Yes, you can. Actually, many of our students do their internship in NGO or MPO. So that's also a great chance to, you know, gain work experience and serve the better good of the community at the same time. So can you do it overseas? Yes. So I will discuss about that during the global exposure part. Now, we understand that it's a very challenging time for 17, 18-year-olds to, you know, move away from home, go to the college, meet a lot of new friends and challenges as study. So we have great mentorship program to help you with that. So we have amazing peer mentorship program where you can learn from your fellow students, or we have alumni mentorship program where alumni come back and, you know, share the experience at HKBU and also their experience after they leave the college. And then we have the industry leaders mentorship program where you get like firsthand updated knowledge about the industry, and also it's a great chance for networking. Now I have put competition here. And for many students, you know, usually when they see competition, they were like, whoa, that's not for me. Competition is only for the best student. I'm not that. I don't want to go into competition. I get so nervous. I understand that, but at HKBU, competition is a chance to grow. So we believe in growing in challenges, and students of different faculties programs are encouraged to take part in competition. You can see there are many photos here of our students all smiling. The great thing about taking part into competition is that first, you learn to work as a team. Secondly, you can nurture your leadership skill. And third of all, and most important of all, you learn to fail. You don't always win in competition, but it's a great experience, and maybe someday you will win. But then before that, it's great experience that prepare you for the challenge that you might face when you leave the college. Last but not least, our service learning. I understand that many of you are doing a lot of community work in your high school, and you probably want to carry on. And I'm very happy to tell you that we have a great center for innovative service learning. And actually, you are looking at their program list here on the side on this very nice infographic. I will show you how. So here is one of the programs that we offer. You see a massage table here. Well, actually, it's what we call toilet. It's a Chinese medical massage that helps people with bone problem or back problem, you know. I mean, it often happens to the elderly. So in this program, I'll still actually visit the elderly at their home. Many of them live alone, and they are accompanied by the professional to, you know, give care and also give some medical support to those elderly. And there is another example of a program that is named Hong Kong Cinema and Hong Kong culture. As you can see, there is a cinema setting here. In this program, our student will visit, interviews the community, people who live around the cinema, and they also have a free screening where they invite underprivileged family to join the screening and to enjoy and to experience that beautiful Hong Kong culture that we call Hong Kong cinema. So the great thing about having service learning in our curriculum is that you don't have to struggle whether you have time for service learning. It's part of your study. You can serve and also study at the same time. All right, we have finished the out-of-classroom learning. Last but not least, the exciting global exposure. So at HKBU, as I mentioned, we have quite a lot of exchange partners, and I'm really proud that given the size of our university, we have all these opportunities available to our students. I'm gonna, you know, divide that into three parts, and I'll start with student exchange. So as mentioned, we have over 350 exchange partners, and we have different types of exchange partners. If you are into like ranking, you want to go to some very prestigious university, there is a list. I'm only listing a few. There is a longer list, but I'm putting a few here as an example. Or if you are looking for more exotic destination, we have some extraordinary choices. I personally would love to go to Iceland. I mean, imagine walking to school, looking at the sky and look at this aura and think, well, just another Wednesday. It would be amazing. Or if money is a concern, you can go for some more affordable choice like Egypt, Portugal, Thailand. It doesn't mean that you have to compromise on the fun part or the quality of education. We still have great partners in those countries. And if you are still worried about money, we have financial subsidy for all. So every student who joins the student exchange program, whether you're a local or international student, you will get subsidy from the university. We also offer something we call summer at top universities. As you can see, we have summer programs, opportunity at quite a lot of prestigious university around the world, and that's amazing for our students. So you will find something similar in some bigger university probably, but the competition would be worse. And given the size of our university, it will be, I won't say there is no competition, you still have to fight for it, but if you work really hard, you might actually get it. So that's the beauty of, you know, going to a smaller university with still quite a lot of resources. So for our science student, there is a particular research fellowship scheme where we send our student abroad for a research experience. As you can see here, our student was in UK, and then we also have student going to Australia as well. Now I want to move on to overseas internship, which I have briefly mentioned. Yes, we do send our student abroad for internship through the Metropolitan Attachment Program, for example, where our students do their internship at some major city, as you can see, Singapore, Berlin, Toronto, Sydney, London. And we also have a long-standing relationship with Disney World in Florida. where we send our students for paid internship. And again, if you have to struggle between serving the community and gaining a work experience, you don't have to. You can do it all and overseas. So we have service learning global internship program where you can have it all. Last but not least, study trip. So when I talk to my international students, many of them actually come to me and say they chose HKBU because of the study abroad opportunities, not only for semester exchange or summer program, but also for quite a lot of study trip. So many of the programs offer program-oriented study trip, like this one here, they were in Germany. And then we also have service trip abroad. This one here is to Bali. And I'm not sure if you can see the price here, but it's only 4,000 Hong Kong for, I mean, what, 7 days, including return tickets, meals and accommodation. So it's really affordable for students who would like to serve abroad. We also have theme study trip. For this one, it is on sustainability and the destination was Denmark and Sweden. Now, maybe Manoj can share with us, what is it like to be a student at HKBU? Manoj?
Well, thank you, Sam. And it has not been so much time since I have been to HKBU. It has been just 7 months, but I have made many new friends from all over the world. I have made new friends in the university, and I have made many new friends on my floor. And my roommates are local, so they teach me about the unique Chinese tradition and culture, and I am happy to share mine to them as well. And the picture on the left is taken during the BBQ party that we have had in the first semester at the top of our student residence hall. I am with my Malaysian friends and a Chinese friend there. And in the middle picture, I am with an Irish friend and my Indonesian friends. And this picture was taken in front of a haunted house organized by local students. And on the right, this is the open semester meetup, and this is a group of international students that we are here at HKBU. I'm at the back, so probably you will not see me here. We also have an international association here in HKBU. It facilitates to convey the information from university, especially to international students, as well as if there are some problems of international students in the university, then they raise the problem or issues of international students and convey effectively to the international office or university management committee. And we celebrate a great cultural diversity here in HKBU. This picture was taken during the international festival that was organized on 22 to 23 October 2019. And I'm with my Nepalese friends here. And we prepared a typical Nepalese cuisine on those days. And we shared that cuisine, we shared that food to other students, other friends, and we tasted there as well. So it was so much fun to know about others' culture, others' food, others' dress, and some of our Nepalese sisters also showcased typical Nepalese dress on the stage. And on that day, I felt like I had traveled the whole world. And apart from this cultural diversity, I am also a Nepalese language conversation class tutor at HKBU Chaplain's Office. So I feel myself proud, I feel myself glad that I have brought a language from a small Himalayan country back in the university and teach others the Nepali language as well as learn their language. So it has been so much fun that it has been such a sharing experience with people all over the world here in the university. And probably when you are abroad, you are not going to hit the book 24 hours, right? So I did the same. Back in January, I visited Ocean Park. And apart from Ocean Park, there are plenty of locations in Hong Kong where you can escape from your ordinary life. There is Disneyland, which I think most of you have heard about. And there are other plenty of hiking locations where you can relieve your stress, get a motivation to study and work again.
All right, such a great program. Thank you, Manoj, by the way. Such a great program. How much does it cost? So I will go through with you one by one. For tuition, it's around 18,000 US. For personal expenses, it's around 5,000 US. And for the hall residence, it's a little bit less than 2,000 US. Rounding up, be around less than 25,000 per year and talking about 9 to 10 months because during the summer, many students return home. So if you are still worried about money, you can actually work on campus because international students are allowed to work on campus for up to 20 hours a week. So many of our students actually do that. They work at the cafe or academic departments or administrative departments like us, or you can also work for, you know, the student hall if they're hiring. And on average, the rate is around $6 per hour. So some of our students actually support themselves by working and studying at the same time. So Manoj, maybe you can give us a, you know, first-hand experience of what is it like. Is it expensive to live in Hong Kong? How much does it cost?
Okay, here is a reference of how much things cost in Hong Kong. Our McDonald's value meal cost us around $3.2. A set of meal at a local restaurant cost us around $5.1. And I have been cooking in these days. So a home-cooked meal, according to my experience, cost me around $3.8. And a train ride from Kulantong, where our university is located, to Mongkok, which I think is the most densely populated place on the earth, cost us just around $0.2. So this is pretty affordable here in Hong Kong, thanks to the student travel scheme of the MTR. And similarly, we get discounts in movie theater and in shopping malls, in Festival Walk. For your reference, Festival Walk is a shopping center nearby our campus. Similarly, in cultural activities also, we get discounts, and in public transport also we get discount being a student. So I think this reference will provide you some insight of how much things cost in Hong Kong.
Great! It seems like a good life to be a student in Hong Kong. But I'm also happy to tell you that we also offer scholarships to international students. So we have three different kinds of scholarships available to international students. The first one here on the left is University Admission Scholarship. So you can see the full scholarship all the way up to $24,400 US dollars. That covers everything from tuition to student residence and personal expenses. We also have tuition waiver and half scholarship. Some of the faculty offer one-off scholarship to potential applicants. So there is a different amount, as you can see, from 10,000 Hong Kong to 70,000 Hong Kong. And then we have the Hong Kong SAR Belt and Road Scholarship offered by the Hong Kong government. So it's available to students from Indonesia, Malaysia, Myanmar, Thailand, and other Belt and Road countries. For the first two ones, you don't have to apply separately. So basically, all the applicants will be considered for scholarship, and for those of you who are competitive, you might actually get an offer with a scholarship. For the Belt and Road Scholarship, we will nominate, as a university, we will nominate our admittee from those countries for the scholarship if they are applicable. So let's go into how to apply for HKBU. It's actually very simple. You do the application online, and then you'll be invited for interview or audition or test on Skype. So you don't have to come to Hong Kong, don't worry about it. And then that will be a result. So a successful applicant will receive either a firm offer or conditional offer. And here are the requirements that we accept. As you can see, we accept most of the international qualification, and you can apply, you know, with IB or SAT or AP or ACT or GCA A level. You don't have to apply with everything, just either or will do. And this is our requirement for English proficiency. And as you can see, we accept different kinds of curriculum. So you can actually use your IB English result to fulfill the English requirement, or SAT or A-level English result. You don't have to do IELTS or TOEFL if you have those. We usually run three rounds of application. So the early round usually start in September, late September until late November. The main round usually is scheduled in December until early January. And the extended round is in January until May. So right now we are still in the extended round for, you know, the new academic year that starts in September, all the way until end of May. Now I want to invite Manoj to talk to you a little bit about tips on application and interview, because after all, he is a full scholarship student. So I want to listen to him as well. Manoj, please.
Okay, thank you, Sam. After my application has been successful, I have made some tips on application and Skype interview. So my first tip on application would be read the instructions carefully. because most of the mistakes happen when you do not read the instruction carefully, and please do not let this happen in your application. My second tip would be provide all the requested information. If you leave any blank fields or if you provide incomplete information, it seems that you are not paying attention or you are not completely interested in applying. So please do not let this happen in your application. And my third tips would be proofread. And after you are done proofreading, give it to someone who can correct you, because typos on your college applications are really sloppy. The fourth one is choose your referee wisely. Please ask the recommendation letter from the teachers or counselors who know you well in the classroom as well as out of classroom. And please provide enough time for them to write your recommendation. Do not go in the last hour. Give time to them for the thoughtful recommendation, and please be sure to thank them at the last. And my fifth tips would be make sure your essay represents who you are. Essay is the only option which I think in the application where you can represent your true personality. So please do not copy from the Google. In fact, admission staffs are really experienced people, and they can easily identify whether that is the real you or whether you have copied someone else's story. And my sixth tips would be apply as early as possible. Do not wait for the deadline to come, because doing haste in the last hour may be going to be waste. So please do not let this happen in your application. Now, regarding after your application is reviewed, you will have an interview. And to appear in interview, please come prepared. Please research about the university at the website, at our website, www.hkbu.edu.hk, so that you can become familiar with the academic buildings, the programs you have applied, the lecturers who teach those programs, and the school's rich culture, rich history and tradition, so that it shows you are enthusiastic to be in the campus community. So please come prepared before the interview. My second tips would be practice before the interview. Rehearse online with your friend. Please look into the webcam. Please have a rehearsal so that you can identify whether you look into the webcam to have a direct eye contact or whether you look into the screen. Please always try to look into the webcam while facing an interview. And I have categorized the interview questions into four categories here, and there are some more. The interview questions may be about yourself, or about your choice, or about your competency, or about your aspirations. So please prepare these questions, have these questions as a reference, and prepare accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Manoj. And before we close on this presentation, I want to give you a quick briefing on how we deal with COVID-19 here at HKBU. So maybe Manoj can share a little bit with us on the class arrangement and how is it like ever since this happened. Manoj?
Well, Sam, let's talk about the crisis part. You know, the life has not been easier since January. Since the outbreak of the virus, life has not been easier. Our face-to-face class has been suspended since January, and after 4 days of the suspension of face-to-face class, teaching and learning is being delivered via the online learning platform. Teachers deliver lecture through Zoom video conferencing, and sometimes they pre-record the lecture and upload it to HKBU Moodle, which is an online learning platform of Baptist University. Recently, around a week ago, we had our midterm exams, and we wrote our answers in the paper by being in our room, and then we scanned the answers and then we submitted it to HKBU Moodle. We do the same for assignments, and we give presentations also via the Zoom meeting. And it was not easier. I would be honest in this. It was not easier in the very beginning to shift immediately from the face-to-face class to online learning, because we have never had such an experience. But now we have become familiar with this thing. And though online learning can never replace face-to-face class, but I think we do not have any options left. And I think we need to try to get best out of this in this situation of crisis. But the most satisfying part is, like, you get emails every day from academic registry, from the president, from international office, from your faculty, and from student appeals regarding the guidelines, the recent WHO guidelines, and as well as other guidelines on how to keep our surrounding sanitary, how to keep maintain personal hygiene. And university distributes face mask at the service counter of our residence hall, and hand sanitizers have been kept in each and every nook and corner of our universities. So I think this has been a really a sense of love and care in this difficult time for us. We are being far from our home, but university has still not run away from its duty to provide its responsibility to secure our better future, as well as to provide quality education without having a gap. So I think the steps taken by the universities is praiseworthy. I have taken this as a midlife crisis of our life, and I am facing it with courage. Thank you.
Thank you, Manoj. You're right. This has been difficult, and I must say is I feel very strongly for the high school leaver this year, because it must be really hard to be in the midst of uncertainty and confusions at the same time. So what we do at HKBU is that we have been keeping a very close eye on the situation. We understand that there will be cancellation of public exam or defer or postponement of announcing exam results and so on. So we are ready to work with students on one-on-one basis. We will also take a holistic approach in evaluating each application, and we will look into not only your transcript or predicted grade, but also your interview performance and your community service track record and so on. And also we will try to if there is alternative offer by the examination offering bodies, we will definitely try to honor that as far as appropriate. So we will work along as the situation evolves, and we are ready to support our high school leaver this year. So please, if you are still planning for your future, I understand it's really tough, but don't give up on it. All storms shall pass. We shall be hopeful. All right, so that actually concludes our presentation. Here is my contact. My name is Sam Wong. You are most welcome to write to me directly. I'm responsible for international student recruitment. You can find my email address here, and you can see a QR code here under e-contact where you can scan it and fill in a form. So you don't have to do that whole, oh, dear Ms. Wong, la, la, la. You just fill in the form, let us know what you're interested in, and I will email you with the program specific information. So that's it for us today. Maybe we can answer a few questions from the audience, if any. Let's see if we have any questions here. Okay. Scholarships. So, okay, right. So someone is asking if scholarships are available to international students. Let's go back to the scholarship slide here. So we do offer scholarships to our international applicant. And for international applicant, we refer to non-Hong Kong ID and non-Chinese passport holder, of course, because then we are from the same country. So you are not international, right? So all non-Chinese and non-Hong Kong ID card holder are eligible for the university admission scholarships and the faculty one-off scholarship. And when it comes to scholarship, it really, we really do take a holistic approach. So it's not just, your grades, but also, for example, your recommendation from your teacher and your interview performance, that counts a lot as well. Okay, so I think we have a question for Manoj. Do you still have exam or assignment that you have to hand in when you do the online class? Is it still the same?
Thank you for the question. We still have our assignments. Our classes are like regular, but just not face to face. We are having an online learning. Our assignments are the teachers send us the questions, and then we need to submit. We need to do it in our home, and then scan the paper and submit it to HKBU Moodle, which is an online learning platform. And we still have exams. We still have final exams on the original schedule. And In the final exams, lecturers have said that we need to open this video, and then they will look at us, and then we will have to write in front of them, and then we will have to submit by scanning the paper. So we still have exams and assignments going on.
So to answer that question, I also want to add that some of the faculty will ask for, say, online tests, not just like, you know, scanning the paper, and some will do like an extra assignment, as I have heard from other students. So basically, they still have to do what they have to do. It's not like, oh, it's online learning, so I can wake up at noon. Or no, they still go to class very diligently, as I understand from Anosh as well. So
I have got another question from me as well. They have one of our audience have asked how labs will be carried out, and during this time of suspension of face-to-face class, we do not have any lab activities. But after the situation gets over, university had said that our normal lab will be conducted during the summer or after the situation returns to the normal. So our course material will be delivered to the full extent. We try to get best out of the situation, but we do not have lab right at the moment. We do not have lab that those labs where we have to really go to the laboratory, like the physics lab or biology lab or chemistry lab. We do not have such kind of lab, but we still have a computer lab. We are still designing our coding. We are still doing coding, and we are making games. So those laboratories where we can still do from our home, that kind of course is still going on. But those laboratories that we need to go really into the laboratory, which we cannot perform at the home, those are suspended, and those will be carried out in summer or when the situation returns to normal.
All right, so I also have a question for entrance requirement. Is Chinese required? That's a great question. So as we mentioned, English is the medium of instruction at HKBU, but there are certain subjects that require Chinese proficiency. As I mentioned, Chinese medicine, for instance, and then also translation, because we teach Chinese English translation, and then there is Chinese literature, and the language is definitely, you know, required for students who are interested in that program. So there are a few programs that require Chinese, and on the other hand, some students may wonder whether there is subject requirement. Actually, other than Chinese medicine, there is no program requirements for our bachelor degree. So you do not have to study, for example, business to apply for business program. No, you just have to fulfill the minimum requirement as shown here, and then you can apply for the program. Do we have? Okay, I think we will go for the last question, which is whether you can do minor. Right, so actually, yes, in many programs, you are allowed to do minors. Some we don't call it minor, like in bachelor BBA, students do more than one concentration. So you can do like double concentrations. But then also there are programs when you can choose like a major and a minor. But really, my advice for high school students is that let's start college first, because it could be really tough. It's a very different learning model. Maybe Manoj can share, you know, is it different? Like, because many high school students come to me and say, I want to do double major, double minor. And I'm like, but you don't want to spend, well, first, it could be really tough. And secondly, you don't want to spend all your time on study. You still want to save some time for fun and internship and surface learning. What is your opinion on that?
Well, Sam, according to my experience, I don't think I can do double major. Even though I have good grades in single major, but I don't think I will be able to do double majors. Unless, I think one needs to study at least 8 to 9 hours at home if he or she does a double major. So I don't think that would be a good idea. But if you are committed, then you can apply for a double major as well in our university.
You know what, guys? Aim high, go for it, but also take it easy. And I think that will really wrap up our presentation today. So again, here is my contact. Feel free to take a photo of it and go to fill in the form so that we can contact you. And last but not least, stay well and healthy. Thank you again for joining us today. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Stay safe where you are. Wash your hands more often than you do before. Wear masks and avoid crowds, please. Bye-bye.
Bye.